This program is brought to you by the Vegetarian Society of Hawaii, a nonprofit organization dedicated to sharing with the community the many benefits of a vegetarian diet. Free monthly meetings include vegetarian experts found locally and on the mainland, quick and easy cooking demonstrations, and healthful and delicious food samples. Members enjoy an informative quarterly newsletter, social activities, and discounts at many vegetarian-friendly restaurants and health food stores. For an application, call 944-8344. That's 944-8344. Or visit our website at www.vsh.org. vsh.org.
Dr. Bill Harris is a founding member of the Vegetarian Society of Hawaii and has been a valuable and dedicated volunteer for these many years. In his talk tonight, he will present the ethical, environmental, and health benefits of a vegan diet. Some of you may not know that Dr. Bill is an expert on the trampoline. He was the Big Ten trampoline champion in 1950, and he is the sponsor and coach of the Hawaii High Flyer Trampoline Club at McCully Rec Center. Dr. Harris received his BA degree in physics from UC Berkeley in 1958, graduating with honors. He received his MD degree from UC San Francisco in 1963. In 1964, he initiated and was the first chief of the emergency department at Scripps Hospital in La Jolla, California. He was with the Southern California Permanente Medical Group in Los Angeles from 1965 to 67, and in 67 also served in Vietnam as volunteer physician in charge of a civilian pediatric ward. He's also an avid pilot and skydiver, jumping out of perfectly good airplanes as often as once a week. He was with the LA County Hospital Emergency Department from 67 to 1970, and he was with the Hawaii Permanente Medical Group Emergency Department from 1970 until 1998. Prior to his retirement, he was founder and director of the Kaiser Permanente Vegetarian Lifestyle Clinic here in Honolulu. He's the author of the book, The Scientific Basis of Vegetarianism, which is available here tonight for sale on our literature table. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Dr. Bill Harris.
This was a jump on 912-00. My cameraman was Greg Rowe, and that's a forward 5.5 somersault. And a backflip. And here's the landing. So that's it for me in skydiving. And now I'd like to tell you about the scientific basis for vegetarianism. Relentless mathematical probabilities underlie nature, and evolution appears to be a fundamental process in the universe. Protons and electrons form, and they are drawn together to become hydrogen atoms. By gravitation, the hydrogen atoms become stars, which form into galaxies. As the stars burn, they fuse hydrogen into heavier elements. The most massive stars eventually blow up, spreading the elements through local space. The elements come together again in a few billion years and planets form which have all the heavier elements. About 92.8% of the matter in the universe is hydrogen and 7.1% is helium, so only 0.1% is left for the heavier elements which are so abundant here on Earth. Carbon, nitrogen, and oxygen are the chief players in the game of life. 20 other elements are also essential, and for some, human recommended dietary allowances, RDAs, have been set. The remaining organic nutrients are synthesized in chemical pathways which have developed during the 3.5 billion years of organic evolution on Earth. Given a primitive atmosphere with hydrogen, water vapor, ammonia, and methane, a random lightning bolt can assemble amino acids in a hurry. The amine group of one amino acid links to the carboxyl group of another, a process which can be repeated indefinitely with the production of long-chain proteins. Hundreds of amino acids exist in nature. More can be synthesized in the laboratory, but only about 36 are used in higher animals, and only 20 of those are involved in protein metabolism. Here's a molecule of methionine, an essential amino acid. The carbon atoms are light brown, the hydrogen's white, nitrogen is blue, and sulfur is yellow. Plants and bacteria can form all 20 amino acids. Humans and other animals cannot synthesize about half those required. The dependence of animals on plants lies in the number of enzymes necessary to synthesize the essential amino acids, average 5.9 enzymes, versus the number necessary to synthesize the non-essentials, average 1.5. Charles Darwin frowns on unnecessary metabolic baggage. If someone has to carry it, better the plants. Vitamins are organic molecules in food required for normal metabolism, which cannot be synthesized in adequate amounts by the human body. Here's the structural formula of thiamine, which is vitamin B1. It starts with a sulfur atom and fills out with carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, and nitrogen. It's synthesized by all higher plants and by many bacteria, yeasts, and molds. It is not synthesized in animal tissues. Most vitamins are key structural parts of enzymes which catalyze chemical reactions in the body. All of the true dietary vitamins are synthesized by single or multi-celled plants. None of them are made by animals. There are some special case vitamins. This is niacin, formerly vitamin B3, but it fails the rigorous definition of vitamin, since with 60 milligrams of dietary tryptophan, an essential amino acid, 1 milligram of niacin can be synthesized in the body. Plants and most animals can synthesize ascorbic acid, vitamin C, but prehumans probably lost the ability 25 million years ago as a result of a mutation which was non-lethal and in fact adaptive, since vitamin C was a plentiful component of the arboreal primate diet. This is beta-carotene, probably the true vitamin A, a photosynthetic plant pigment which acts with chlorophyll to trap solar energy. By enzymatically splitting one molecule of beta-carotene at the line, two molecules of retinol are formed. It is essential to skin, vision, and reproduction, but it can be made in the body from beta-carotene. Nevertheless, the U.S. Hospital Formulary refers to beta-carotene as a drug and retinol as vitamin A, which is probably an exact inversion of reality. There can be no retinol in the animal kingdom unless somewhere in the food chain an animal is eating carotene. Excess carotene is non-toxic, except for yellowing of the skin, but about 10 cases of retinol intoxication are reported yearly, largely due to its inclusion in vitamin preparations. Here is calciferol, one of three potent calcium-regulating hormones synthesized in the body to bypass the vagaries of dietary calcium. Cholesterol is made in the liver. A hydrogen is enzymatically removed from the number 7 position on the B ring. The molecule is then moved to the skin, and when a photon of ultraviolet light hits that unstable B ring, it opens up to form calciferol. Historical errors led to its misclassification as vitamin D. Ergosterol, a similar molecule, is synthesized by yeast, and after irradiation becomes a so-called vitamin D, which is added to milk, which would otherwise have somewhat less than human milk. Inadequate exposure to sunlight leads to rickets without supplements, but since it can ordinarily be made in the body, calciferol fails the definition of vitamin, whether from plant or animal sources. A dozen cases of intoxication are also reported yearly due to its inclusion in vitamin preparations and in milk. This complex molecule is vitamin B12, which acts with folic acid in the creation of DNA. While it's found mostly in animal source food, it is only made by bacteria, including intestinal bacteria. It's not presently clear what conditions, if any, are necessary to enable its subsequent absorption in humans. Vitamin B12 supplementation should be considered by all vegans until this issue is settled. Nevertheless, this vitamin is only synthesized by plants of the single-celled variety. Here are three fatty acids, two of them essential, linked to a glycerol molecule to form a neutral fat or triglyceride. Linoleic acid is only synthesized by plants and stored in their seeds. Linolenic acid is synthesized in the chloroplasts of green plants. Arachidonic acid, previously called an essential fatty acid, can be made from the other two. The fatty acids synthesized in an animal reflect its species, but the type of fatty acid stored in the animal reflects dietary fat, so the fat you eat is the fat you wear. So all the essential nutrients for humans are made either by stars, plants, or microorganisms. None of them are made by animals. If we were cats, it would be different. Cats are carnivores and have been for as long as there have been cats. They require arachidonic acid, carnitine, retinol, and taurine, which can only be found in animal source foods. But we're not cats, so any essential nutrients obtained from animal foods originated in the plant kingdom, and our use of animal food amounts to secondhand nutrition. That many humans still eat animals reflects feeding strategy, not biochemistry. The experience of millions of healthy vegetarians and vegans who use no animal source food confirms that there is no need for it in the human diet. After 3.5 billion years of prebiotic evolution on Earth, self-replicating DNA molecules emerged which duplicated themselves faster than the watery environment could destroy them. The first cells were watery little bubbles of DNA and other organic molecules with internal structures walled off from a hostile environment by two layers of fatty phospholipids. Cells could then remain solitary in the environment as bacteria and protozoa, or they could colonize and distribute various functions among the colony's member cells. This was the strategy of higher plants and animals. Some cells synthesized their own nutrients from carbon dioxide and water, using sunlight to drive chemical reactions which release oxygen. This option was employed by photosynthetic bacteria and higher plants. A second option was to eat organisms which employed the first option. This was a strategy of the animal kingdom, and within that kingdom, a third option arose, the subgroup of animals which also eat other animals. Here's an animal cell membrane featuring large red protein globules, the fatty bilayer made mostly of long-chain saturated fatty acids, and little yellow cholesterol molecules acting to prevent the fats from sliding over one another. On the left, an animal cell. On the right, a plant cell. Plants use a similar membrane bilayer, but the fatty acids are shorter, less saturated, and there's no reinforcing cholesterol because on the outside is a cell wall made of cellulose, a tough, rigid polymer of sugar. Animal cells are flexible like inner tubes. Plant cells are like flimsy inner tubes with tires around them. And that's why animal source food is full of saturated fat and cholesterol, and plant food is not. After the first cells appeared, it was a relatively short 500 million years to the present host of organisms which exploit every ecological niche. There's little information on the diet of these early animals, but the shrew-like creature who preceded the first primates was a small insectivore. This 260-gram tarsier looks a lot like the little shrew who first went up in the trees 60 million years ago. The sharp teeth and the big eyes suggests that he eats bugs at night. He's a nocturnal insectivore. Here's the gorilla at the other end of the scale, the largest primate, one of humanity's closest genetic relatives, and a strict vegetarian in the wild. Kinetic energy is proportional to mass, and the gorilla would waste more energy pursuing insects than he could recover by eating them. This 80-kilogram orangutan eats only fruit and leaves. These beautiful people are 25-kilogram Asian langurs who dine on the leaves of the trees in which they live. And here's Jimmy Durante and the family, three proboscis monkeys. They're diurnal vegetarians. During 56 million years of primate evolution, the predecessors of man became large vegetarians, exploiting the fruits and leaves of their arboreal habitat. The heaviest contemporary primates are also vegetarian. On the x-axis is the percent of daily calories from animal sources. On the y-axis is average species weight. The gorilla weighs 160 kilograms and eats no animal food. The orang checks in at 75 kilograms and eats no animal food either. Human vegans are in good company at 70 kilograms. The chimpanzee at 50 kilograms is beginning to branch out a bit and gets about 4% of calories from birds, eggs, and small mammals, the rest being fruit and leaves. There are three more vegetarian species, and then the white gibbon at 5.7 kilograms breaks the chain, and from there on down it's bugs all the way. Due to scaling effects, the consequence of falling out of trees is severe for large primates who've moved into the most dangerous part of the tree to find the only food they can afford to catch, the fruits, leaves, and nuts. In the absence of parachutes, selection pressures favored the emergence of large brains capable of accurate judgment calls. The hominids emerged 3 million years ago, a short time compared to the 56 million arboreal years, and evidently broke with their predecessors. Descending from the receding forests of drought-ridden Central Africa, they made many revolutionary adaptations, one of which was the scavenging, hunting, and eating of other animals. Meat is calorie dense, and the high fat content ensures a high calorie weight ratio, an important factor in primitive food transportation. But a remarkable change began 12,000 years ago in the Mediterranean basin, the agricultural revolution. Instead of hunting wild animals and collecting leaves, nuts, and tubers, the early agriculturalists began growing grains and herding animals. The animals became sedentary and fat, and the easily stored grains never did have the high nutrient values of fresh but perishable green vegetables. Paleontologists now find the bones of early agriculturalists to be less robust than those of the late hunter-gatherers. This graph shows that in a given period of time, one can get more calories from turkeys and pigs kept on a known area of land rather than stalking meat as a contemporary Kung or Aceh hunter. One can then extract still more calories if the land has been planted in crops for direct human consumption rather than used to graze animals which are subsequently eaten. Such figures could have driven the agricultural revolution in the direction of vegetarianism, but the new rules also favored the acquisition of more land and animals and the start of organized warfare for that purpose. The cheap grain-based food of the agricultural revolution also fueled a population surge. In 12,000 BC, a million people lived on Earth. By 6,000 BC, there were 16 million, and they promptly devoured what otherwise would have been a luxuriant food supply. Population pressures led to the unsanitary cities of the Middle Ages, and epidemic disease followed. There are at least 1,800 diet books in print. Few of these books, taken from one shelf in a public library, mentioned a vegetarian diet, and none of them mentioned a vegan diet, although there are almost no obese vegans. These books feature movie stars and astrology, but no mention of the one thing that really works, a permanent whole food vegan diet. It's fairly intuitive that consumption of animal food increases the intake of fat. The data points here are so dense that only a few country labels are given for clarity. Six Asian countries keep median weight and height figures for their children. These six countries are not big-time fat eaters, so the graph does not show obesity, but only a tendency in the countries using the most animal fat. Recent work indicates that high fat intake is the distinct difference in eating behavior between obese and lean adults. A little more information from the World Health Organization confirms this. Satiety is detected by stretch receptors in the stomach, which has a capacity of about 1 liter. Chemical receptors in the central nervous system detect amino acids, fatty acids, glucose, and probably minerals and vitamins. On a vegan diet, the stomach will be filled and nutrient requirements met before the calorie RDA has been reached. This is why vegans are generally healthy but slender. Fat's good buddy cholesterol is rugged stuff. It's synthesized by most animal cells by repeated enzymatic linkages of acetate molecules. Carbon rings assemble easily, but it's hard to disassemble them. Several species of bacteria can break down the cholesterol nucleus into carbon dioxide and water, but animals can get rid of cholesterol only by dumping it, modified slightly, as a bile acid in the stool. Plants synthesize small amounts of cholesterol on the pathway that leads to the other plant sterols, which botanists suspect are involved in plant reproductive cycles. Some animal hormones are shown on the right, also derived from cholesterol: testosterone, the male hormone, and progesterone, the female hormone. Aldosterone causes the kidney to reabsorb sodium in exchange for potassium, making it unnecessary for animals to eat crystalline salt. The 1,100 milligram RDA for sodium, about a half teaspoon of salt per day, was arrived at by survey. The actual requirement determined by scientific study is only about 250 milligrams a day. Humans synthesize 500 milligrams of cholesterol per day, further evidence that the molecule is essential to normal function. Most omnivores eat an additional 500 milligrams a day, which may raise the serum cholesterol above the liver's ability to modify and dump it. There are tiny amounts of cholesterol in plant foods such as yams, potatoes, and even spinach and taro, according to information compiled from several plant physiology journals. But the cholesterol content of plants is less than 1 milligram per 100 calories, and this is below the level of detection by USDA assay methods. So the cholesterol content of plant foods is always reported as zero. It's unlikely that a vegan diet would exceed 10 milligrams of cholesterol per day, so for practical purposes, it remains a no-cholesterol diet. Since fat and cholesterol are insoluble in water, they are carried around in lipoproteins, little bubbles of fat, protein, and cholesterol, which circulate in the bloodstream. Lipoprotein synthesis is under genetic control, but the diseases of cholesterol accumulation are not fatal until well past reproductive age, so these random and vegetarian lipoprotein genes of our primate ancestors probably can't be weeded out by natural selection. On a vegan diet, lipoproteins are irrelevant, since vegans average serum total cholesterol levels of 150 milligram percent. Coronary heart disease, CHD, killed 900,000 Americans in 1986, but in the Framingham Heart Study, CHD vanished at cholesterol levels below 150 milligram percent. In 1881, Dr. Carl Voigt surveyed German laborers and found they consumed about 120 grams of protein per day. The average American still consumes about 103 grams, of which 70 grams is animal protein. The recommended dietary allowance, RDA, for protein has finally come down to 0.8 grams per kilogram of body weight per day, which is about 10% of calories from protein. RDAs are set at two standard deviations above mean requirements to ensure that only 2.5% of the population will fall below nutrient requirements. But as the bell graph shows, this ensures that 97.499% of the population will exceed its nutrient and calorie requirements. Excluding processed foods, junk foods, and recipes, 100-gram portions of various foods in 10 categories were averaged for protein content. With the exception of fruit, all the categories exceed the dotted line 10% protein requirements. If one consumed nothing but averaged foods from the vegetable category, one would get about 25% of the day's calories from protein. Most ethnic cuisines intuitively mix plant proteins for a satisfactory amino acid balance. The Chinese mix soy with rice, the Mexicans mix beans and corn, the Italians mix pasta and vegetables. The balance question originated from studies on weanling rats, which grow fastest on an amino mix which resembles rat's milk. Egg protein comes close, so for many years eggs were the amino gold standard. In 1941, William Rose studied amino acid requirements in adult males and then doubled his figures. Rose's figures are similar to the amino acid composition of human milk. Rat's milk is about 25% of calories from protein, while human milk is only 5.9%. The amino acid content of plant food has been described as inadequate by some authors, but a diet of vegetables only would achieve 500% of the RDA for the limiting amino acid methionine. The well-documented allergic reactions to fish are due to its high content of histidine, which undergoes bacterial decomposition to histamine. Meat is high in nucleic acid, which breaks down to uric acid. If the serum uric acid goes too high, it precipitates in joints, causing gout. Proteins are well recognized for structural properties, but they have another important function. They are the words nature employs to communicate information between and within living organisms. Webster's New World Dictionary, with an alphabet of 26 letters, has about 1.42 times 10 to the fifth, or 142,000 words. Protein is a sequence of the 20 biological amino acids, which are the alphabet in the protein language. Given a protein with a length of 100 amino acids, there are 20 to the 100th, or 10 to the 130th, possible sequences in which those aminos can be linked. Only a fraction are used. The human genome only codes for 100,000 proteins, although the immune system can discriminate about a billion foreign proteins. Ordinarily, about 98% of dietary proteins are digested and absorbed as harmless amino acids. However, in about 2% of individuals, fragments of whole protein may be absorbed into the circulation. Protein is identified by its amino acid sequence. If the sequence is more than 35 amino acids long, the immune system may form antibodies against it. These four nucleic acid bases are the business end of DNA. Three bases in sequence form a codon, which specifies one amino acid. Hence, a long sequence of bases specifies a protein about a third the length of its gene. Shown here is a typical printout comparing the genes coding for human and bovine milk proteins. The vertical lines show the identity of bases generating the two proteins, which for this short segment is 92%. The printout went on for 1,460 base pairs with an overall identity of 80%. 90% of insulin-dependent diabetes mellitus, IDDM, patients have antibodies to their own pancreatic islet cells. A recent report found that all of 142 IDDM patients had antibodies to cow milk protein. These antibodies apparently attacked a protein in the insulin-making cells of the pancreas. It's likely that there is little similarity between plant and animal protein sequences other than their common use of the same 20 amino acids. Therefore, while plant protein may induce allergy, the antibodies do not cross-react with body proteins. A diet free of animal protein may be therapeutic in antigen-antibody disease. In 1991, Barsotti reported reduced proteinuria and maintenance of normal serum albumin in nephrotic patients on the vegan diet. Kjeldt and Craw described remission of arthritis on the vegan diet, and in 1985, Lindahl demonstrated clinical and biochemical improvement in 92% of asthmatic patients placed on a vegan diet. Nearly everyone has seen variants of this famous colored poster. We are advised to eat foods from each of the basic four food groups to ensure adequate nutrition. The two animal food groups, milk and meat, are said to be high in calcium and protein, respectively, and to have large amounts of riboflavin, iron, niacin, and thiamine. If we load some key foods from the poster into a computer spreadsheet and sort for the foods of the highest calcium content, we get this graph. Clearly, Swiss cheese, ice cream, and milk have the most calcium. Then we sort for foods with the highest protein content and get this graph. It looks as if the two animal food groups do have unique properties. The milk group dominates the calcium sort, and the meat group dominates the protein sort. But the foods were sorted by nutrient weight ratio. Suppose we sort for foods with the highest calcium calorie ratio instead. Significant changes have occurred. Chard and broccoli move ahead of cheese. If in fact one sorts the entire USDA database by calcium calorie ratio, about 10 leafy green vegetables make the list ahead of the first dairy product. All the foods to the right of the dotted line exceed the RDA of 800 milligrams of calcium per 2,400 calories of food. Sorting by protein calorie ratio produces more surprises, and vegetable foods are scattered high among the animal foods. All of the foods to the right of this dotted line exceed the RDA of 10% of calories from protein, some by wide margins. So if foods are sorted by nutrient calorie rather than nutrient weight ratios, animal foods lose their clout and the whole basic four concept evaporates. Well, which sorting method is right? Suppose we make a bowl of soup with a half ounce each of potato, onion, carrot, beans, mushrooms, and beet greens. The dry weight is 100 grams. We add water and transfer to a pot for boiling. the finished soup weighs 290 grams. Except for small losses in vitamin content from boiling, the nutrient value of a bowl of soup is the same as its dry ingredients. But compared to those ingredients by nutrient weight ratio, it would score 100 over 290, or about one-third for all nutrients. The idea is absurd, yet nutrient weight comparison is at the heart of the basic four food group scheme. The soup is 19% of calories from protein, 77% carbohydrate, and 4% fat. It exceeds the RDA per calorie for every nutrient save vitamin B12. By contrast, this fast food meal, a milkshake, a hamburger, pickle, French fried potatoes, and a bun, contains the basic four food groups. It is 14% of calories from protein, 57% carbohydrate, and 29% fat. It's high in fat and cholesterol and seriously deficient in fiber, vitamins A, B2, B6, C, E, niacin, folate, magnesium, and zinc. This light, lean ham loaf is represented as 97% fat-free, which simply means that out of 100 grams, only 3 grams are fat. But FDA rules required a small label from which one can easily compute the true values. In a serving, there are 30 calories and a gram of fat. Each gram of fat carries 9 calories, so the true fat content is 100 times 9 times 1 divided by 30, or 30% of calories from fat. Labeling rules allow fat to be rounded off to the nearest integer, so food companies use serving sizes small enough so that 1.4 grams of fat becomes 1 gram of fat. This ham is probably really 9 times 1.4 divided by 30, or 42% of calories from fat. Whole milk is represented as 4% fat, or 4 grams of fat per 100 grams of milk. But in 150 calories of milk, there are 9 grams of fat, so the milk is actually 9 times 9 divided by 150, or 54% of calories from fat. Carbohydrate and protein each carry about 4 calories per gram. Foil food industry flimflam with this formula. Look on the label for the calories per serving, multiply 4 times the carbohydrate and protein per serving, 9 times the fat per serving, divide by the calories per serving, and multiply those answers by 100 to get the percent of calories from carbohydrate, protein, and fat. This unassuming, unadvertised, and unlabeled spinach is actually 49% of calories from carbohydrate, 40% protein, and 11% fat. If it were labeled logically by nutrient calorie analysis, the label would read like this, with a massive oversupply of almost all nutrients. Popeye was right. But the basic four concept promoted by the National Dairy Council only works if foods are sorted by nutrient weight ratio, which is an ideal strategy to sell animal food, which is a good way to keep excess calories, cholesterol, and saturated fat in the diet, which is a splendid way to grow an obese, arteriosclerotic, cancer-ridden nation, which is what we have. Since 1897, there have been 24 food group schemes listing anywhere from 3 to 11 basic food groups and emphasizing dairy products and meat. All were backed by respected nutritionists who failed to let on that classifying foods by nutrient weight ratio is irrational. There's no RDA for weight in the diet. It's not a nutrient, it has no physiological function, and it's simply a means of measurement. By contrast, there is an RDA for calories, which are a measure of the biochemical energy needed to maintain life function. If food is abundant, humans will eat until calorie requirements are met. On a vegan diet, most of the foods eaten meet or exceed 100% of the RDA per calorie for each nutrient, and the apparent complexities of balancing nutrient requirements against excess cholesterol and fat intake disappear. Nutrient requirements are met automatically, and nutritional advice finally reduces to this. The USDA price support program, financed by the Commodities Credit Corporation since 1933, has been pushed this way and that by generations of special interest politicians. The program claims to help small farmers, but most of the help actually goes to farmers whose income already exceeds that of the average American. One thing does seem straightforward, however. Fruits and vegetables, among the foods most essential to human health, get no price supports. By contrast, the dairy industry gets over $1 billion in annual price supports, a thousandfold return on its $1 million political action contributions. Of these 21 price-supported crops, most are either irrelevant or injurious to human health. But barley, corn, sorghum, and oats are the big winners in the USDA sweepstakes. While a $16 billion windfall might appear to benefit mostly the grain farmers, 70% of the feed grains are fed to animals, which are then eaten by humans. In 1987, USDA price supports for corn were $15 billion, but only 3% of the crop was for human consumption. If grain farmers sold on the free market, they would probably charge higher prices for less feed grain, and the price of dairy, meat, and poultry would rise as profits fell. The efficiency with which animals convert plants to animal food for human consumption varies by species. This chart indicates that chickens waste 74% of the plant protein they eat to make eggs, and young sheep waste 97% of the plant calories they ingest to produce lamb. Labor costs impact on food production. Not surprisingly, animal food is more labor-intensive than plant food. The improved efficiency of pork production since 1969 probably reflects factory farming techniques. Animal food and field crop protein production requires more land than horticulture. The conversion efficiency, labor efficiency, and land use efficiency of animal foods reflect the rate at which animals contaminate the water supply, waste fossil fuel, and degrade the environment over and above the rate at which plant agriculture does the same. A wide spectrum of analysts, economists, and politicians feel that USDA price supports have been a disaster to the U.S. economy, the small farmers they're supposed to help, and to struggling third world agricultural systems as well. The USDA has also played a major role in nutritional education. Political pressure has been applied via the USDA by the egg, dairy, meat, and poultry industries against lower cholesterol and dietary fat recommendation. The Basic Four Food Group Scheme was devised at the Harvard Department of Nutrition in 1955. The department, begun in 1942, was short on funds, so support was obtained from outside sources. By 1986, over $20 million had come from private, governmental, and industrial benefactors, including the above. The Center for Science and the Public Interest found six other nutrition professors accepting grants and assorted freebies from these companies and from other drug, food, soft drink, and food vending machine companies. One party admitted to taking $635,000, but two of the professors did not respond at all. Other sources of funds for the Harvard Department of Nutrition were these drug companies. Pharmaceutical houses exploit the urgent human wish that health be restored with no more effort than the popping of pills into the mouth, and by financial leverage select those authorities who support this wish to serve as media spokesmen. The U.S. medical budget was about $760 billion in 1991. It's projected to go to $2 trillion by AD 2000. About $577 billion of the initial figure went for patient care, and $270 billion of that went to the treatment of diseases now known to be partly the result of animal source food consumption. There has been a 27-year increase in life expectancy at birth since the turn of the century, mostly from improved sanitation and food availability that occurred in the last century, reducing infant mortality in this one. While life expectancy at age 65 has gone up 5 years since 1900, annual medical costs per capita have risen from $25 to $1,200. Most of the increased longevity occurred before medical costs began to go through the ceiling, so if increased longevity is the goal of medical care, the costs do not appear to be a superlative example of a bargain. The U.S. Public Health Service keeps track of major killers. Not all these problems have an obvious relationship to diet, and others that do are not shown. There are multiple factors in the cause of most disease. World Health Organization and Food and Agriculture Organization data show that many diseases correlate with animal food consumption. If one purposely set out to plug the circulation, short of inserting corks, it would be hard to find a better combination than cholesterol, which deposits in artery walls, and animal fat, which slows red blood cells and capillaries and predisposes to clots. The per capita intake of animal fat derived from FAO data has a strong correlation with death from thrombosis, as reported by Hutt and Burkett. The computed correlation coefficient R, which reflects the goodness of fit of the regression line, is 0.93. The p-value of 0.007 indicates about a 0.7% chance that the apparent correlation between animal fat and the death rate from thrombosis is only a mathematical coincidence. If all the points fell on the regression line, the R value would be 1 and the P value 0. Not surprisingly, there's a negative correlation between the percent of calories from vegetable sources and thrombosis. This negative correlation applies to most of the following graphs also, although it will not be shown since it's obvious that the more plant food in the diet, the less animal food. Note that the x-axis reflects percent of daily calories from plant food, not intake of vegetable fat, since it is not a health promoter either. Animal fat comes with its own supply of cholesterol, which deposits in vascular linings and causes coronary heart disease. The R value here is 0.76, and while a p-value less than 0.01 is usually taken to indicate a significant correlation, the p-value here is very much smaller than that. Animal fat increases the synthesis and excretion of carcinogenic bile acids. Simultaneously, the lack of fiber slows intestinal transit time, thus exposing the bowel lining to those carcinogens for a longer period of time. Animal fat also induces excessive and fluctuating levels of sex hormones. Some types of breast cancer are hormone dependent. Although a recent survey of 90,000 American nurses found no relationship between fat consumption and breast cancer, none of the women in the study were vegan, and none of them were on the 10 to 15% fat intake of the countries in the lower left of this graph. A later study suggests that low fat intake even reduces mortality in women who already have undergone treatment for the disease. Prostate cancer is also hormone dependent, and endometrial cancer appears to follow the same pattern. Adult onset diabetics tend to be overweight. Although there are genetic and viral triggers, many insulin-dependent diabetics suffer from an autoimmune disease brought in part by exposure to cow milk protein. Beef and dairy proteins have been identified as a trigger for lymphoma and Hodgkin's disease, and WHO data suggests that animal protein may not be helpful in musculoskeletal problems either. Nephritis is due to an antigen-antibody reaction in the kidney. The filtering membrane becomes thickened and loses the negative electrical charge, which prevents the leakage of protein such as albumin. One type of nephritis due to IgA immunoglobulins can be aggravated by cow's milk. So it's not surprising that WHO data also indicate a weak correlation between the intake of animal protein, previously shown to be a risk factor for autoimmune disease, and death from genitourinary disease. The risk appears to be even stronger from egg consumption. Multiple studies have demonstrated increased urine calcium loss on high-protein diets supplemented with sulfur amino acids, the source of urinary sulfate. Animal food is high in protein, and the protein is high in sulfur amino acids. Calcium taken from the blood to neutralize urinary sulfate must be replaced by calcium from the bone. Consumption of animal protein correlates with the rate of hip fracture, which in turn reflects the incidence of osteoporosis. We multiplied the yearly costs as estimated by health services such as the American Heart Association and the American Cancer Society by R squared, which, smaller than R, is that part of the variance attributable to the risk factor. The American Lung Association estimates $65 billion a year as the medical cost of tobacco use, and the Center for Science and the Public Interest estimates $100 billion a year as the medical cost of alcohol consumption. So $123 billion as the medical cost for the animal food addiction is probably a very conservative estimate. It does not include several other food-related problems. For instance, trichinosis is a rare but severe roundworm infection acquired from pork. of 33 foodborne parasitic and microbial diseases transmitted by food, 28 are from animals. 97 out of 116 laboratory culture media used to grow and isolate bacteria which cause human disease contain blood, serum, brain, heart, bile, eggs, and other animal material. By contrast, only 1 out of 9 media used to grow bacteria which cause plant disease uses animal material. In short, humans are unlikely to get oak wilt by eating acorns, and tapeworms can't live in trees. Of incidental interest, slaughterhouse workers, while doing work most of their customers cannot bring themselves to do, have one of the highest industrial accident rates in the U.S. Animal food advocates claim that there are areas in the world that are so mountainous that you can only graze animals on them. However, here are some terraced rice paddies over in China that seem to be doing pretty well, although these appear to be fairly steep hills. They're raising rice on these hills. And there are now about 8.1 billion farm animals in the United States, and the total humans are about 260 million, so we're outnumbered 30 times by farm animals. These farm animals consume various amounts of water every day. Dairy cows take in about 35 gallons of water, cattle about 12 gallons, hogs about 4 gallons, humans 1 or 2 quarts, turkeys and chickens much less because they're smaller animals. Well, when you add up the numbers, turns out that because there are so many chickens in our country, they're using a huge amount of water. Cattle come in second, hogs are next, dairy cows come in here, and we come in. The U.S. farm animals are using 30 times as much water as U.S. humans. Individual animals put out a certain amount of fecal matter every day. Cattle, about 55 pounds a day, hogs maybe 4 pounds. Chickens, not much because they're small animals. We put out about 9 ounces. When you add up all these numbers, we get these figures. The cattle are producing huge amounts of manure, 600 million tons. So the U.S. farm animals are generating 130 times as much fecal matter as U.S. humans. All of the diseases in this chart are transmitted to humans by some sort of animal food, with the exception of anthrax, of which we have heard a good deal recently. This has been intentionally introduced into the population, but so far it's only resulted in about 5 fatalities. By contrast, consumption of animal food leads to about 75,000 cases of serious type of E. coli, salmonellosis, about 40,000, and the rest of these diseases in descending order. Anthrax itself also comes from animals. It used to be called wool sorter's disease. North Carolina previously specialized in that fine crop tobacco, but after that went under due to health concerns, the state turned to raising pigs in large confinement operations that featured manure lagoons on the premises. When Hurricane Floyd blew through in September 1999, it devastated the pig factories, and there were dead pigs and pig poop all over the place, including the waterways. North Carolina is still begging for millions of dollars to clean up, and they're not alone. The 2001 Farm Bill of the U.S. House of Representatives proposes to use $1.2 billion a year of taxpayers' money for the next 10 years to deal with the manure disposal problems of U.S. animal agriculture. The American Medical Association says this character is far more successful at marketing cigarettes to children than to adults. Taxpayers are gouged 3 times. First, tax dollars are used to administer USDA tobacco allotment programs. Next, the tobacco industry gets an annual 1/3 tax deduction on its $5 billion advertising bill, which forgives about $1.75 billion. Lastly, we all chip in to pay the $65 billion medical bills for the citizens who smoke. Similar arguments apply to the animal food industry. First, our taxes are used for outright $1 billion supports to the dairy industry and as de facto $10 billion supports for meat and poultry in the form of feed grains. With the profit margin gained from price supports, the animal food interests fund multi-billion dollar tax-deductible propaganda campaigns that lead the public to make further use of disastrously unhealthy food, which could not hold its own on a free market. Lastly, our taxes go to pay the $123 billion medical bill for all the heart attacks, cancers, and related calamities which inevitably follow. This problem is political. What the government gives away is price supports, advertising tax deductions, and medical care for preventable disease. It recovers from citizens via the Internal Revenue Service. Surely in a time of monetary shortage, the USDA should cease to support unhealthy agricultural products, and tax deductions for health-sensitive advertising should be eliminated. If they can't tell the truth, why should we pay them to teach? If animal-source food were really necessary for human health, taxpayer support might be justified, but animal-source food is barely compatible with human health, animal agriculture devastates the environment, and you can decide for yourself the ethical aspects of what you're now seeing.
Richard Wagner, 1880. I start from the religious conviction that the degeneration of the human race has been brought about by its departure from its natural food. The only basis of a possible regeneration, a return to it.
Dr. Anna Kingsford, 1882. The ordinary flesh eater, if he be a man of any perception, is always fain to acknowledge, on being pressed, that there is something in the usual mode of feeding which clashes with his finer sense of what ought to be. He would rather not talk about the slaughterhouse, and more or less frankly admits that he cannot associate the idea of slaughter with what are called the utopian theories of existence.
In 1887, Tolstoy said, "If a man's aspirations towards a righteous life are serious, if he earnestly and sincerely seeks a righteous life, his first act of abstinence is from animal food."
Ruth Harrison, 1920. That animals are sensitive to pain and discomfort is obvious from the fact that in the higher animals, the sensory and nervous systems are similar to those of man.
Henry Bailey Stevens, 1963, said, "In their concern over the world crisis, most peacemakers have given little heed to the fact that man operates two major forms of blood violence. The larger of these is not the intermittent spasm of war, which has occurred perhaps once in a generation. It is the steady, day-by-day intake and outflow of the abattoir."
This program is brought to you by the Vegetarian Society of Hawaii, a nonprofit organization dedicated to sharing with the community the many benefits of a vegetarian diet. Free monthly meetings include vegetarian experts found locally and on the mainland, quick and easy cooking demonstrations, and helpful and delicious food samples. Members enjoy an informative quarterly newsletter, social activities, and discounts at many vegetarian-friendly restaurants and health food stores. For an application, call 944-8344. That's 944-8344. Or visit our website at www.vsh.org. vsh.org.